بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيك ما يحب ربنا ويرضاه، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا مزيدا، أما بعد. Today inshallah we continue with the second principle in the book of Ash-Shaykh Abdur-Razzaq, حفظه الله تعالى. Ashru Qawā'id fi Tazkiyyatin-Nafs, 10 principles regarding the purification of the self. He says, القاعدة الثانية الدعاء مفتاح زكاة النفوس. The second principle, dua, supplication, is the key to self-purification, or the purification of the self. So here he says ad-du'a, and it's known to everybody what is du'a. Da'a yad'u, to supplicate to Allah Azza wa Jal. Imam Ibn Faris rahimahullah ta'ala, he said in Mu'ajam Maqayis al-Lugha, he said ad-dalu wal-aynu wal-harfu al-mu'tal aslun wahid. He said the letters dal and then ayn, and then the vowel letters, meaning waw, alif, or ya, aslun wahid, or have one principal meaning, or one word that carry meaning. وهو أن تميل أن تميل الشيء إليك بصوت وكلام يكون منك. Right, and what it means, this dal, ayn, and then a vowel letter, waw, alif, or ya, is to make something lean towards you or turn towards you by using your speech or a sound from yourself. That's dua, lughatan. Okay? So lughatan, linguistically in Arabic, when somebody says da'a yad'u, it means to call by either saying a word or by making a sound, someone to turn towards you. Right? So I say to you, from afar, if you're far away, I say, Ya Nafi', ta'al. Oh Nafi', come here. I say, hey, doesn't mean anything. But this is a dua, lughatan. Okay, so linguistically it's a, not a supplication, but it's a call to somebody to turn towards you, okay, or something. Right? So that's the had shar al-lughawi. That's the parameters of it in terms of the linguistic meaning. Du'a shar'an is to call upon Allah Azza wa Jal. That's du'a yad'u. Right? It means to call upon Allah Azza wa Jal. So the du'a can take many forms. The forms of du'a many. Right? When you say, Ya Allah, Ya Rabbi, du'a nida, right, to call upon Allah Azza wa Jal, just to say, Oh Allah, Oh my Lord. Then there's the du'a of mas'ala. You ask Allah, Ya Allah, Allah marzuqni, Allah maftah alayya, Allah give me provision, you know, give me openings, and so on and so forth. Then there's a du'a that istighatha, right, to seek protection. A'udhu billah, Ya Rab, inni astaghithu bika, Ya Rab, right, and so on and so forth. Then there's like dua al-isti'ana, Allahumma a'inni, and there's many forms of dua. But the point is, all of it returns to you asking Allah Azza wa Jal for something. So you're asking Allah to turn His attention to you specifically, to give you something or to protect you from something, and you know, like this. So this is the meaning of dua, right? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa said in a hadith, الدُّعَى هُوَ الْعِبَادَةِ. الدُّعَى هُوَ الْعِبَادَةِ. The supplication in and of itself is worship of Allah Azza wa Jal. In one hadith, which is weak, but the meaning is correct, he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, or he's claimed to have said, that it's الدُّعَى مُخُ الْعِبَادَةِ. Right? The dua is the head of worship. It's the head of worship. So, it shows you the makana and the manzila of dua. which is like the head of, from the body. So if you've cut off the head, what happens to the body? It dies. What happens to the head without the body? It dies. They are in need of one another, right? So the body needs, in order to be alive, it needs the head. So if you remove the head, so if you remove the dua from the body of your worship will what eventually? It'll die. Maybe it'll shake, it'll, you know, do like this and then it falls to the ground and it dies. And such is the manzila, such is the stature and the status of dua from to the, or to the rest of your dua, worship. So that's why Shaykh Abdur-Razzaq, Hafidhullah, he says, الدُّعَاء مِفْتَاحُ زَكَاتِ النُّفُوسِ. The supplications you make to Allah Azza wa Jal is the key to cleansing yourself and purifying yourself. He says, قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ لَيْسَ شَيْءٌ أَكْرَمَ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى مِنَ الدُّعَاء. Right? There's nothing more noble to Allah Azza wa Jal in his sight, Azza wa Jal, than dua. Nothing is more honored to him. Nothing is more honored. Yes? And the hadith is in the Sunan of Imam al-Tirmidhi and the Sunan of Imam Ibn Majah, and Shaykh al-Albani graded it as Hasan. And the hadith, al-dua huwa al-ibadah, is also a sahih hadith narrated by Imam Ahmad in his Musnad, Imam Abu Dawood, Imam al-Tirmidhi, Al-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, all of them in their Sunan collections, graded sahih by Imam Al-Albani rahimahullah. And then he goes on to say, فَالدُّعَاءُ مِنْ أَفْضَلِ الْعِبَادَاتِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. So therefore dua is from the most noble and virtuous forms of worship to Allah Azza wa Jal. لِأَنَّ فِيهِ إِظْهَارًا لِلْعَجْزِ وَالْإِفْتِقَارِ وَالْتَذَلُّلِ وَالْإِنْكِسَارِ. Because in it you make apparent, the Muslim, the mu'min, the abd of Allah Azza wa Jal, the slave of Allah Azza wa Jal, he makes apparent his incapacity, his iftiqar, his poverty, his tadallul, his lowliness, wal-inkisar, his brokenness in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. وَالْإِعْتِرَافِ بِقُوَّةِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ وَقُدْرَتِهِ. And in it there is an awareness of you're showing an awareness of your, or of the power of Allah Azza wa Jal and his qudra and his might and his ability. وَغِنَاهُ وَإِغْنَائِهِ. And his freeness of any need, subhanahu wa ta'ala, of anybody. وَغِنَاهُ وَإِغْنَائِهِ. Right? And his complete and utter freeness from any need. Right? And him, جل وعلا, causing others to be free of anybody else. So it is him, جل وعلا, who is in control of causing you to be free of anybody. Right? Whether that's monetarily, emotionally, whatever it may be. When the mu'min becomes dependent completely and solely upon Allah Azza wa Jal, knowing that he's completely in need of him, and Allah Azza wa Jal is not in need of anything, and he's the one who allows people to be independent, then you are, as he says, you are independent. You're only in need of Allah Azza wa Jal. So money, food, water, you become less and less worried about it, right? People rent, car insurance, yada yada yada. When a believer becomes dependent completely upon Allah Azza wa Jal, these things become like a secondary thoughts to him. He's not worried about it. And you make idhar, and you make open and clear to the world and to Allah Azza wa Jal, his kibriya, the high and lofty nature of Allah Azza wa Jal. Yeah? وَجَبْرُ كَسْرِ خَوَاطِرِ أَعْدَائِهِ فَضْلًا عَنْ فُضَلَاءِ أَحْبَابِهِ وَأَوْلِيَائِهِ. And his ability, جَلَّ وَعَلَى, to control and mold the thoughts of his enemies, let alone the thoughts whispers and what goes on in the mind of the ones he loves and his awliya, and his friends. So a lot of people, what do they complain about? Akhi, I can't control my thoughts. My thoughts are sporadic and erratic, and they're, you know, all over the place. So they're like, I can't focus. If you give yourself up to Allah Azza wa Jal completely, right? يا أيها الذين آمنوا ودخلوا في السلم كإيش كافة. You know, Allah Azza wa Jal, He makes مخاطبة. He speaks to the مؤمنون. He speaks to the believers, and He says, "Oh, you who believe, enter into the submission. Enter into Islam. Enter into submission to Him, جل وعلا كافة, completely, solely, fully." And one of the most apparent things we can glean from this ayah is that there are people who enter the fold of Islam who are Muslims, and walilal hamd, but their Islam is incomplete. They haven't fully submitted to Allah Azza wa Jal, right? So the one who does this, his hal is like this. Allah Azza wa Jal frees him of having any need of anyone or anything else except Him, right? So even his thoughts become a slave to Him, Jalla wa Ala. So Allah Azza wa Jal forces only good thoughts into his mind. Only good things enter his consciousness. And that takes taba'an, that takes exercise, and that takes practice, and that takes discipline to discipline your mind and discipline your soul. But that comes with tazkiyah, that's the whole process, right? Giving yourself up to Allah Azza wa Jal. He goes on to say, وَلَهُ أَثْرٌ عَظِيمٌ فِي فَتْحِ أَبْوَابِ الْخَيْرِ. And it has an amazing effect in opening up doors to goodness. كَمَا قَالَ شَيْخُ الْإِسْلَامِ فِي وَصِيَّتِهِ لِأَبِي الْقَاسِمِ الْمَغْرَبِي. Like Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he means, said in his wasiyyah, in his advice or counsel to al-Imam Abul-Qasim al-Maghribi, rahimahullah, was a great imam from Morocco. And he said, الدُّعَاءُ مِفْتَاحُ كُلِّ خَيْرِ. الدُّعَاءُ مِفْتَاحُ كُلِّ خَيْرِ. And this kalam from Shaykh al-Islam, which means supplicating to Allah Azza wa Jal, is the key to all goodness. So when I look this up, it says here in Majmu' Fatawa, but he actually also mentions it in a book that was, it was basically a letter he wrote to this Imam, Abul Qasim Yusuf al-Sibti, or Subti, rahimahullah, who was known as Abul Qasim al-Maghribi, rahimahullah. Okay? And it's a book called Al-Wasiyyat al-Sughra, the concise or the small advice. He asked about three things. We someday, inshallah, can read it together. It's a beautiful book. And so I said, maybe we can read it. And so we can read it. It's very short. And so what he does say here is, he says, you should increase with making istikhara. Okay? And then he says, وَمِنَ الدُّعَى. And you should make increase in what? Supplicating to Allah Azza wa Jal. فَإِنَّهُ مِفْتَاحُ كُلِّ خَيْرٍ. For indeed it is the key to all goodness. وَلَا يُعَجِّلُ فَيَقُولُ قَدْ دَعَوْتُ فَلَمْ يُسْتَجَبْ لِي. And you don't be hasty. You shouldn't be hasty in your supplicating to Allah Azza wa Jal by saying, I've supplicated to Allah Azza wa Jal, but He's not answering. وَلْيَتَحَرَّ الْأَوْقَاتَ الْفَاضِلَةِ. And the mu'min, the Muslim, should look for and be vigilant regarding the times where the du'as are accepted. The virtuous times. For example, كَآخِرِ اللَّيْلِ, like the last third of the night. وَأَدْبَارُ الصَّلَوَاتِ, and right after the salawat, right? Or there's two tafsirs for that. Right after the prayer, right? For example, you make rak'atain and then you make du'a. Or in the fard salah, right before the taslim. Right before the taslimatain, you make after the tashahud and the darud ibrahimiyah, and then you make a du'a. The du'a before the taslim, the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith that الدُّعَى لَا يُرَدْ, that this prayer here is never, it's never rejected. This supplication you make there is never rejected. So that's what it means, أَدْبَارُ الصَّلَوَاتِ. It can mean right before or right after. Right before the end or right after it finishes. وَعِنْدَ الْأَذَانِ. Right, when you hear the adhan, you repeat after the muadhin, and then between the adhan and the iqama, you make dua. This is another time where the Prophet ﷺ said that the du'as are not rejected. وَوَقْتُ نُزُولِ الْمَطَرِ وَنَحْوِ ذَلِكَ. And when the rain comes down. When the rain comes down, that's also a time where the Prophet ﷺ said that the du'a is accepted. وَنَحْوِ ذَلِكَ. And like what, and so on and so forth. So these are the times where the du'a is accepted. And this shows that the importance of du'a, because there's many times the du'a is accepted. Allah Azza wa Jal, وَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدِ, He created multiple times during the day, multiple times during the week, multiple times during the month of a Muslim, that the du'as are accepted. So if you're making du'a, Ya Allah, purify my soul. Ya Allah, help me to conquer my own self and my own desires. SubhanAllah, look how much time you have. Look how many opportunities you have. 5 times a day you hear the adhan, hopefully with Allah Ta'ala. You can make the du'a, right? In the prayer, in the sajda, right? Right after the prayer, so many times, right? Right after you make wudu, there's many times. So, walillah alhamd, Allah Azza wa Jalla has made that a wide and vast door of opportunity. Walillah alhamd. So he goes on to say, فَكُلُّ خَيْرٍ تَرْجُوهُ لِنَفْسِكَ وَتُرِيدُهُ مِنْ خَيْرَاتِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ فَطْلُبْهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَالْجَأْ إِلَيْهِ فِي نَيْلِهِ وَتَحْصِيلِهِ. So every goodness that you hope for yourself and that you want from the goodness of this world and the hereafter, then seek it from Allah Azza wa Jal and turn to Him Jalla wa Ala to be able to achieve this thing in your life. You want this thing in your life? You want to gain it? You want to achieve it? Then turn to Allah Azza wa Jal. وَقَدْ وَعَدَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى مَنْ دَعَاهُ وَالْتَجَأَ إِلَيْهِ بِالْإِجَابَةِ. And Allah Azza wa Jal has promised the one who turns towards Him and supplicates to Him that He will answer his call. فَقَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. For indeed Allah Azza wa Jal, He says in the Quran, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ أُدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. In Surah Al-Ghafir, in verse number 6. Right? Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, say, وَقَالَ, يعني Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ, your Lord, He said, أُدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Call upon me and I will answer you. This is a promise from Allah Azza wa Jal. وَلَا يُخْلِفُ اللَّهُ وَعْدَهُ. And Allah Azza wa Jal never breaks His promise or His guarantee. Never. Yeah? As Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran. وَقَالَ الْأَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عُمَرْ بِنَ الْخَطَّابِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ. In Umar bin Khattab, the leader of the believers, he said, Al-Faruq, he says, radiallahu anhu, إِنِّي لَأَحْمِلُ هَمَّ الْإِجَابَةِ. Indeed, I bear the responsibility. إِنِّي لَأَحْمِلُ هَمَّ الْإِجَابَةِ. Indeed, I do not bear the responsibility to answer anything. وَلَكِنْ هَمَّ الدُّعَاءِ. But I am responsible for making supplication. فَإِذَا أُلْهِمْتُ الدُّعَاءَ فَإِنَّ الْإِجَابَةَ مَعَهُ. SubhanAllah, look at the thought process of the Sahaba. So he says, so indeed, if I am inspired to call upon Allah Azza wa Jal, then indeed the answer is also with it. Because it's Him that's inspiring me. The tawfiq to make dua is from Allah Azza wa Jal. So if Allah is giving me tawfiq to make dua, if He's giving me and inspiring me with the ability to make dua, then indeed the answer is also with the dua. Because it's from the same source. The one who inspired you and made you able to make dua is the one answering your call. Allahu Akbar. So look at the positivity, look at the mindset of the Sahaba. وَعَنْ مُطَرِّفِ بِنْ شِخِّيرِ رَحِيمُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَرَضِيَ عَنْهُ. And this was a great Imam. مُطَرِّفِ ibn Abdullah ibn Shikhir. Imam al-Dhahabi رحمه الله تعالى, he says in Sirah A'lam al-Nubula, Al-Imam, Al-Qudwa, Al-Hujja, the great Imam, the exemplar, the example, Al-Hujja, the proof, right? And then he goes on to say, حَدَّثَ عَنْهُ أَبِيهِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ. So Al-Shikhir, here was a Sahabi of the Prophet ﷺ. And this was his son, Mutarrif. Mutarrif ibn Abdullah bin Shikhir. Abdullah bin Shikhir was a Sahabi, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ. So he narrates from his own father, Mutarrif, he narrates from his own father. وَحَدَّثَ عَنْ عَلِي رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ. وعمار بن يسار. He narrated from Ali. He narrated from عمار بن يسار. He narrated from أبو ذر. And Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها عنهم أجمعين. And معاوية رضي الله عنه وعمران بن حسين وغيرهم. And many from the Sahaba, major, great Sahaba, and from the Kibar التابعين, from the major التابعين. Right? وحدث عنه. And the people who narrated from him were Al-Hasan al-Basri, Imam Qatada, right? Thabit al-Bunani, رحمهم الله جميعا وخلق سواهم. And many, many others. Yani, when I was looking him up, the list of people who narrated from him and he narrated from were long. So I just narrated people who most people would recognize. Most people recognize Qatada. He was a student of Ibn Abbas. Right? Al-Hasan al-Basri is Imam. The Kibar al-Tabi'een, everybody knows him. Imam Thabit al-Bunani or al-Bunani, he's known, especially if you study Hadith, he's known. Mutarrif ibn Abdullah ibn Shakhir, rahimahullah, every single Imam of the six books of Hadith narrated from him. So he's, you know, when you look him up in the books of Hadith and you look him up in the books of Rijal, you know, the books of the men who narrated Hadith, the narrators of Hadith, there's beside his name sometimes an ayn like this. The ayn means that all six Imams of Hadith, Imam Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and An-Nasa'i, all six of them narrated from him. Yes, he was a great Imam of Hadith. So Mutarrif ibn Abdullah ibn Shakhir, rahimahullah, he says, تَذَكَّرْتُ مَا جِمَاعُ الْخَيْرِ. I remembered and tried to revise with myself, what is the thing that gathers all goodness? فَإِذَا الْخَيْرُ كَثِيرُ. And when I thought about it, the goodness is in a lot of things. الصوم, fasting, الصلاة, prayer. وَإِذَا هُوَ فِي يَدِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَ. And all of these things are in the hands of Allah عز وجل. وَإِذَا أَنْتَ لَا تَقْدِرُ عَلَى مَا فِي يَدِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَ إِلَّا أَن تَسْأَلَهُ فَيُعْطِيَكَ. And you don't have any ability to get what's from Allah Azza wa Jalla, what's in His hands, except that you ask Him and He gives it to you. Right? You have to ask. So he says, Rahimahullah, فَإِذَا جِمَاعُ الْخَيْرِ الدُّعَى. So therefore, I came to the conclusion that the thing that brings all goodness or gathers all goodness is a dua. This is narrated by Imam Ahmad in his Kitab Az-Zuhd, his book of asceticism. Yeah? So look at this. Look at the thought pattern of our Salaf. Right? They understood salah is good. They understood siyam is good, fasting, prayer, all these things are good. But they realized that don't have the ability to do those things except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the tawfiq. So he said, so I came to the conclusion that the thing that gathers all goodness in it is a dua. Subhanallah. And then he goes on to say, Shaykh Abdur-Razzaq, وَفِي بَابِ التَّزْكِيَةِ صَحَّ عَنَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَنَّهُ قَالَ فِي الدُّعَاءِ أَوْ فِي دُعَائِهِ. And in the science or in the knowledge of tazkiyah, self-purification, it is authentically reported from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he said in his supplication, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, he said in his supplication to Allah, اللَّهُمَّ آتِ نَفْسِي تَقْوَاهَا وَزَكِّهَا أَنْتَ خَيْرُ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا أَنْتَ وَلِيُّهَا وَمَوْلَاهَا. Oh Allah, give my soul or myself taqwa. It's taqwa, it's piety, it's fear, it's hope, it's love of you, Ya Allah. وَزَكِّهَا. And purify it. أَنْتَ خَيْرُ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. And you are the best of those who purify the soul. أَنْتَ وَلِيُّهَا وَمَوْلَاهَا. You are its protector and its master. And this is a known dua of the Prophet of Allah Azza wa Jal sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's narrated by Imam Muslim in his Sahih. What a beautiful dua. Something that our Prophet Isa sallam is teaching us. Right? And what he's teaching us is something in the writing in the Quran, and we'll come to it. But at the end of the day, the tazkiyah of the heart, the purification of the heart and the soul, is solely in the hands of its creator. Always the Prophet ﷺ, look, this goes back to what we talked about yesterday, that tawheed is the principle and the essence by which you purify yourself. So even now the dua goes back to tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal. You call upon only Allah Azza wa Jal, the creator of your soul, to purify it. He goes on to say, وَفِي هَذَا الدُّعَىٰ إِشَارَةٌ وَتَنْبِيهِ. In this dua, there is a sign and a point of importance. He's bringing your attention to something. عَلَىٰ أَنَّ تَزْكِيَةُ النُّفُوسِ بِيَدِ اللَّهِ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ. عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ. That the purification of the soul or the self is in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal, the knower of the unseen. وَأَنَّ مِفْتَاحَهَا الْأَعْظَمَ هُوَ الدُّعَاءُ وَالْإِفْتِقَارُ إِلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. And the key to it, the grand key, the major key to it, meaning purification of yourself, is dua, is supplicating to Allah. وَالْإِفْتِقَارُ إِلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ. Ensuring your complete state of poverty to Allah and in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. You can't stand in the salah or make dua like, Ya Allah, Rabbi, ighfir li in shit. Oh Allah, forgive me if you want. This kind of attitude doesn't work. When people like, they make dua, they make dhikr, and they go like you're chewing something, you know, like you're chewing gum. It sounds ishada, yeah. There's a difference between somebody says alhamdulillah, 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 and somebody goes alhamdulillah with hudur of his qalb, with presence of his heart, with inkisar al-nafsi amam Allah, with complete brokenness in front of Allah Azza wa Jal, that he's completely broken without him. You're nothing without Allah Azza wa Jal. Right? And you say alhamdulillah. That's different. Then that doesn't work. Even if you say it a million times. But if you say alhamdulillah ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر مرة واحدة, just once, but with complete presence of the heart, brokenness in front of Allah, and with complete humility in front of Allah Azza wa Jal, even saying it once is transformative. It can change your life. With understanding, it can change your life. He goes on to say, ولهذا كان أكثر دعاء النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يا مقلب القلوب أو اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلبي على دينك. And that's why one of the most plentiful or the most common du'as of our Prophet عليه السلام was, O Allah, O turner of the hearts, keep or make my heart firm upon your religion. Right? Because the Prophet عليه السلام understood that that can't happen except through Allah عز وجل. فمتى اجتمع على العبد قلبه وصدقت ضرورته وفاقته وقوي رجاؤه ولم يتعجل بالإجابة وتحرى الأوقات الفاضلة فلا يكاد يرد أو يرد دعاؤه. He says, and so when all of these things gather together for the slave, his heart, his truthfulness in his need and his necessity, and the strength of his hope in Allah Azza wa Jal, and he's not hasty about when Allah Azza wa Jal will answer his dua, and he looks for and he's vigilant about the times where the dua is accepted, then he says, Hafidahullah, it is as if like his dua will never be rejected. فَلَا يَكَادُ يَرُدُّ دُعَاؤُهُ. It is as if almost his dua will never be rejected. He goes on to say, وَأَعْظَمُ مَا يُعِينُكَ عَلَى الدُّعَاءِ مَعْرِفَتُكَ أَنَّ زَكَاةَ نَفْسِكَ بِيَدِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Like we said, and the most greatest of the means by which, or the greatest of the means which will help you upon dua, is to know, or is your knowledge, that the purification of yourself is in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal. هو الذي يزكي من يشاء, and that He is the one who purifies whomever He wills. والأمر كله له وتحت مشيئته. And all of these affairs are in his hands, are under his mashi'ah, his will, and whatever he ordains. جل وعلا كما قال تعالى, like Allah says in the Quran, بل الله يزكي من يشاء. Rather, it is Allah who purifies whomever he wills. This is in Surah An-Nisa, verse number 49. The beginning of the verse, he says, أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ يُزَكُّونَ أَنفُسَهُمْ. Have you not seen those who purify themselves? Have you not seen them? Those who try and they try to purify themselves? Then he says, بَلِ اللَّهُ يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاءَ. Rather, it is Allah Azza wa Jal who purifies whomever he wills. وَلَا يُظْلَمُونَ فَتِيلًا. And he does not oppress even the slightest bit. Right? So he's explaining to you, Azza wa Jal, he's explaining to you that look at the people who try to purify themselves. Look, there's out there people with all the different madhahib and all the different religions and adyan that are out there that claim that they want to do this, Buddhism and, you know, mysticism and all these nonsensical things that all that they talk about is purifying the self. Then Allah says, بَلِ اللَّهُ يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاء. Rather, it is Allah Azza wa Jal who purifies whomever he wills. And then he says, he finishes the ayah, but وَلَا يُظْلَمُونَ فَتِيلًا. And he does not oppress or transgress against anyone even a little bit. This is meaning what? That he will purify those who deserve it. Yeah. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ يُجَاهِدُونَ فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Those who strive in our path and struggle in our path for our sake, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. We will give them guidance to the paths that lead to us, meaning to him, Allah Azza wa Jalla. Right? So the mujahada comes first. Then the hidayah comes. The mujahada comes first. The dua comes first. The tawheed, the ta'seel and the tawheed comes first. Then Allah says, يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاء. Then Allah, he was the one who makes tazkiyah, purification of whomever he wills. And the one he wills tazkiyah for is the one who knows, yeah, the one who's deserving of it. The one who's deserving of it is the one who is upon the tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal. The one who calls upon none except him, Jalla wa Ala. وَقَالَ تَعَالَى. He goes on to say, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ. And if it was not for the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal upon you and His mercy, مَا زَكَى مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ أَبَدًا. None of you, no one from amongst you ever would be purified. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاءَ. But it is Allah Azza wa Jal who purifies whomever He wills. And this is Surah An-Nur, verse number 21. Right? يقول ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما في تفسير قوله تعالى ما زكى منكم. Ibn Abbas, he says in his tafsir, in his explanation, where Allah says ما زكى منكم, and none of you would have been purified. It means ما اهتدى أحد من الخلائق لشيء من الخير ينفعه به نفسه. None from the creation, no single person, jinn or mankind from the creation, would be guided to goodness by which he can benefit himself. Nobody would be guided to that kind of goodness. No one. وَلَمْ يَتَّقِ شَيْئًا مِنَ الشَّرِّ يَدْفَعُهُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ. And he wouldn't be given the ability to protect himself from the harm or ward off harm from himself ever. And then Shaykh Abdur-Razzaq, he says, meaning كُلُّ ذَلِكَ إِنَّمَا هُوَ بِمَحْضِ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ. Meaning, what Abdullah ibn Abbas means is that any goodness that you have in your life that you use to benefit yourself, any harm in your life that you know of that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected you from that can harm you, all of that is purely without any other thing being a sabab, being a reason, it is purely from the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal, and that's it. Nothing we do, we can claim is saying, I deserve this from Allah Azza wa Jal. Rather, it's فضل الله محضا. It is the pure and unadulterated blessing of Allah Azza wa Jalla and nothing else. And this tafsir is narrated by Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari rahimahullah in his tafsir. Na'am. He goes on to say, وقال البراء ابن عازب رضي الله تعالى عنه, the great Sahabi, he says, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم الأحزاب ينقل معنى التراب, that the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم, on the day of Ahzab, when they were, you know, they were digging the khandaq, they were digging the trench, ينقل معنى التراب, he used to carry with the Sahaba. He didn't sit back and watch the Sahaba do stuff. No, he was carrying stones and rocks and dust and dirt himself. وَلَقَدْ وَارَى التُرَابُ بَيَاضَ بَطْنِهِ, and the amount of dirt and dust, it covered the whiteness of his body, of his stomach, it covered it up. So he was covered in clay and dirt. وَهُوَ يَقُولُ, and he was like this, and he was saying this line of poetry, وَاللَّهِ لَوْلَى اللَّهُ مَهْتَدَيْنَا وَلَا تَصَدَّقْنَا وَلَا صَلَّيْنَا. This is what he used to say when he was moving dirt and stones. By Allah, if it wasn't for Allah, we would not have been guided, and we would not have given charity, we would not have worshipped Him, Azza wa Jal. And this is something we took together in the Sahih of Imam Bukhari when we read it. This is narrated by Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim in the Sahih. فَالْهِدَايَةُ وَالْإِيمَانُ وَالْخَيْرُ كُلُّهُ بِيَدِ اللَّهِ وَحْدًا. So guidance, iman, faith, goodness, all of it is in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal alone. وَقَدْ كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَغْرِسُ هَذَا الْأَمْرَ فِي نُفُوسِ الصَّحَابَةِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ. And the Prophet of Allah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to yaghrisu hadha al-amr, he used to plant, embed this thing in the souls of the companions of the Prophet, in his Sahaba, he used to embed this, he used to plant this principle in their hearts. Wa yu'akkidu alayhi bi-istimrar, and he used to continuously emphasize it. All of this, yes. وَفَكَانَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَسْتَهِلُّ خُطَبَهُ بِقَوْلِهِ, because the Prophet ﷺ, every time he gave khutbah, he used to say, مَنْ يَهْدِهِ اللَّهُ فَلَا مُضِلَّ لَهُ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ. Whoever Allah Azza wa Jal guides, then there's none that can misguide him. And whoever Allah misguides, then none can guide him to the straight path. None can guide him. Right? As it comes in Sahih Muslim from the Hadith of Ibn Abbas and other books of Hadith, Abu Dawood and Sunan and Tirmidhi and Al-Nasa'i and Ibn Majah, all of them narrating it from Abdullah ibn Abbas. So Abdullah ibn Mus'ud, except Imam Muslim, he narrates it from Abdullah ibn Abbas. Tayyib, and he ends, Shaykh Abdur-Razzaq, حفظه الله تعالى, he ends by saying, فَهَذَا الْأَصْلُ هُوَ أَعْظَمُ الْأَبْوَابِ لِتَزْكِيَةِ النَّفْسِ. So this principle, meaning turning to Allah Azza wa Jal in dua, to Him alone, Azza wa Jal, it is from the greatest means of purifying the self. فَمَنْ عَلِمَ أَنَّ صَلَاحَ نَفْسِهِ وَزَكَاتَهَا واستقامتها بيد الله عز وجل لجأ إليه وأقبل على بابه ملحا عليه بالدعاء. So the one who knows and has knowledge that the uprightness and the rectification of his self and the purification of his self and the steadfastness of his self upon the deen of Allah عز وجل, all of that is in the hands of Allah عز وجل, لَجَأَ إِلَيْهِ. When he knows all of this, when the female or male slave knows this, لَجَأَ إِلَيْهِ, he turns to him, عَزَّ وَجَلْ. وَأَقْبَلَ عَلَى بَابِهِ, and he comes to the door of Allah عَزَّ وَجَلْ, مُلِحًا عَلَيْهِ بِالدُّعَاءِ, fervently, viciously, aggressively, stubbornly making dua to him, Azza wa Jal. This is called ilhah. Stubbornly making dua. If I ask you, Hakim, please do this for me. Hakim, please do this for me. Hakim, you have to do this for me. Hakim, if you do this for me, wallahi, my day is going to be ruined. Hakim, you have to do this for me. Hakim, wallahi, billahi alayka, you have to do this. This is ilhah. I'm stubbornly and aggressively making dua to you. You have to do it for me. It's called ilhah. Okay? Rajiyan tami'an. With full of hope in Allah Azza wa Jal, liyanalu minhu zakata nafsihi. Full of hope in Allah Azza wa Jal. Stubbornly asking him to purify himself. وَنَجَاتِهَا and or نعم وَنَجَاتَهَا sorry. And asking Allah Azza wa Jal to give himself or herself success in this dunya and the akhirah. وَفَلَاحَهَا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. You're constantly making dua to Allah Azza wa Jal in this fashion, that you're completely broken. You have no one to turn to except Allah. You are stubbornly making dua, insisting from Allah Azza wa Jal in a state of brokenness in front of Him. That Ya Allah, purify me. Ya Allah, purify me. Ya Allah, purify me. Help me to conquer my nafs, my desires. Ya Allah, help me to lower my gaze. Ya Allah, help me to control my shahawat, my desires. Ya Allah Azza wa Jal, help me to leave off the things that I desire from sleep, from food, from drinking overly and excessively, food and drink, sleeping excessively. Ya Allah, help me stand up in the night. Ya Allah, help me memorize the Quran so I can stand in the night, so I could recite your words and your kalam. You have to have sidqu tawajjuh in Allah. You have to have a truthfulness in your turning to Allah Azza wa Jal. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi said in a hadith, ادعوا الله وأنتم موقنون بالإجابة. Make dua to Allah, supplicate to your Lord in a state that you are in a complete and utter certainty that Allah Azza wa Jal will hear your dua, will listen to your dua, will answer your dua. He will answer your dua. It's from the adab of dua to ask Allah in this fashion. You can't do that with the creation. You can't do that with the creation. The creation will get tired of you. They'll slam their door in your face. They'll cut off relations with you. They'll change their number on you. Right? Except Allah Azza wa Jal. إِن لَمْ يُسْأَلْ يَغْضَبْ. If he's not asked, he becomes angry. If you don't ask Allah Azza wa Jal, he becomes angry. And I wanted to read from the kalam of Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, since we finished a little bit early. What he mentions about ilhah fi dua, it's a beautiful thing he mentions. And from the adab of dua, he mentions some really nice narrations in his book Adda'u wa Dawa. Of course, beautiful book by Imam Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah rahimahullah ta'ala wa radiyallahu anhum. He says in that book, The Sickness and the Cure, he says, فصل, the chapter heading الإلحاح في الدعاء, making إلحاح in دعاء. Okay, and like I said, إلحاح is to be stubborn and consistent upon دعاء, it's to stubbornly ask something. لحا ألحا يلح بشيء, he constantly does it, asking,
persistent.
He says ومن أنفع أدويتي الإلحاح في الدعاء, and from the most beneficial of medicines, cures, he says, is this persistence in dua. وقد روى ابن ماجه في سننه, Imam Ibn Majah, he narrates in his Sunan, من حديث أبي هريرة, from the hadith of Abu Huraira رضي الله تعالى عنه. What is his name?
Abdul Rahman
ibn Dawood.
No.
Abdul Rahman ibn Sakhr الدوسي رضي الله تعالى عنهم. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من لم يسأل الله يغضب عليه. The one who does not ask Allah Azza wa Jal, he becomes angry with him. Subhanallah, look at this. When you ask the creation, they become angry. Allah Azza wa Jal, if you don't ask him, he becomes angry. جل وعلا سبحانه وتعالى. وفي صحيح الحاكم, and in the صحيح of Imam Al-Hakim And actually, that's the Sahih Imam al-Hakim is the Mustadrak, is where he took the conditions of Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, for the authenticity of a hadith, and he made istidrak, which means he followed up. He went out into the literature of hadith, he looked for more hadith that fit their criteria. من حديث أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم from Anas, from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام لا تعجزوا في الدعاء. Don't become hopeless in your dua. Don't leave off making dua. فإنه لا يهلك مع الدعاء أحد. For indeed, nobody is destroyed by dua. You can make dua till your tongue becomes dry and it falls out of your mouth. From the moment you're born to the moment you die. For every waking moment you're alive, you make dua to Allah Azza wa Jal. And wallahi, this is from the mouth of our beloved, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as-sadiq al-masduq, the truthful, believed one, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَهْلِكُ مَعَ الدُّعَاءِ أَحَدٍ. Nobody is destroyed because of the dua ever. No one. Right? And then he goes on to say, وَذَكَرَ الْأَوْزَاعِيُّ Imam al-Awza'i, he says, عن الزهري, from Imam al-Zuhri, عن عروة, from عروة, عن عائشة, from عائشة رضي الله عنهما, عنها وعنهم أجمعين. قالت, that she said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, إن الله يحب الملحين في الدعاء. إن الله يُحِبُّ الْمُلِحِينَ فِي الدُّعَى. Indeed, Allah Azza wa Jal, He loves those who are persistent in their dua. They make ilhah in the dua, Allah loves them. This hadith was narrated by Imam al-Tabarani rahimullah, and Imam al-Uqayli, and Imam ibn Adi. But the hadith has weakness. Imam ibn Hajar, he says, تَفَرَّدَ بِهِ يُوسُفْ ibn Sifr بن الأوزاعي وهو متروك وكان بقية ربما دلسه. So this man Yusuf ibn al-Sifr ibn al-Awza'i, he was matruk, meaning he was abandoned by the ulama of hadith. Okay, so not only is he abandoned, this narrator is weak and abandoned, but he made tafarrud, meaning he was the only one who narrated this hadith and by this wording. Okay, the wording, the hadith, what I mentioned here, indeed Allah loves the ones who are persistent upon dua, but the meaning is correct. Okay, the meaning, the ma'na of the hadith is correct بإذن الله تعالى. وفي كتاب الزهدي للإمام أحمد عن قتادة قال مورق. In the book of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal entitled Az-Zuhd, the book of asceticism, he narrates from Qatada, rahimahullah, the student of Ibn Abbas, from Mawarriq, another student of the Sahaba, that he said, مَا وَجَدْتُ لِلْمُؤْمِنِ مَثَلًا إِلَّا رَجُلًا فِي الْبَحْرِ عَلَى خَشَبَةٍ فَهُوَ يَدْعُو يَا رَبِّي يَا رَبِّي لَعَلَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى أَنْ يُنْجِيَهُ. He said, I have not seen a metaphor that is more befitting for the believer than a person stranded in the sea holding on to a piece of wood for dear life. And what all he says and all he makes dua with is, Ya Allah, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, hoping that Allah will save him. This is the mithal, this is the metaphor of the believer. And what does he mean by that? Shaykhana Shaykh Muhammad ibn Sa'id Raslan, حفظه الله تعالى, from the great ulama and muhaddithun of Egypt, he said that this shows that the entire life of the mu'min, of the Muslim, is reduced down to this basic act of worship. Everything that you do, your salah, five times a day that you pray, it's filled with dua. Filled with dua. The Fatiha is a dua. You read parts of the Quran, it's filled with dua. Right? You go down for ruku', you come back, Sami'allahu liman hamida. Allah hears the one who praises him. And then that's a dua. Then you say, رَبَّنَا لَكَ الْحَمْدِ. Right? Why? Because you want to be from the ones who praise him. جَلَّ وَعَلَى. Right? And then you make dua in your ruku', you make dua in your sujood, you make dua بَيْنَ سَجْدَتَيْن, between your two prostrations. And then in your tashahud there's dua. And then you make salawat upon the Prophet, there's dua. And then you make isti'adha from Allah Azza wa Jal from the four things. What are the four things? Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ايش؟ min mahya min fitnat al-mahya wal-mamat. So the fitna of life and death. Wa fitnat al-masih al-dajjal. Wa min fitnat al-adhab al-qabri wa adhab al-nar. So there's four things. One thing is life and death. The second thing is the akhirah. It starts in your barzakh. And then the hereafter, you ask Allah to protect you from the fitna of the grave and the fitna of the hellfire. Right? And then the fitna of Masih al-Dajjal, the fitna of the Antichrist. And then the fitna of what? Mahya al-Mamat, you mentioned.
Azab al-Qabr or Azab al-Nar?
Four things, right? So life and death,
Masih al-Dajjal,
Masih al-Dajjal,
Azab al-Nar,
Azab al-Nar, Azab al-Qabr, Taba barakallahu fik. Those four things in that way. So your salah, bal, I say to you brothers, the word salah, from the meanings of the word salah is ad-du'a. Lughatan, salla, yusalli, in Arabic means to make du'a. When the Prophet Isa was ordered by Allah Azza wa Jal to say, فصلي عليهم أني فدعو لهم. When the Prophet was ordered to make dua for a group of people, that Allah Azza wa Jal said in the Quran, he didn't say فدعو لهم, he said فصلي عليهم. Right? So make salah upon them, quote unquote. When you read the tafsir, it means فدعو لهم. Right? فدعو لهم. Right, and it went from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he said, if you're invited to a person's house, then فصلي عليهم. Right? And when I was younger, I remember I used to go into a person's house, subhanAllah, the jahl. I read this hadith, and somebody invited me to their house for iftar, I think it was. And I went into the house, and I went into the corner, and I prayed rak'atayn. Because I thought that's what you should do. Because I didn't understand, I misunderstood the hadith. So dua is very important, my dear brothers. And from the adab is this, to make ilhah in the dua. Yes? So what did we understand today? We understood that dua is from the greatest keys of purifying yourself. Okay? In all of its forms, in all of its forms. And that the mu'min should be vigilant, the Muslim should be vigilant in making dua and supplicating to Allah Azza wa Jal in the times where he knows that the dua is accepted. And from the adab of the dua, from the etiquettes of dua, from the etiquettes of supplicating to your Lord, is that you supplicate him first and foremost with husn al-dhan, with good thoughts about him, Jalla wa Ala, the good thoughts about you, Lord, with complete yaqeen that Allah Azza wa Jal will answer your call, will answer your dua, will answer your supplication. And then you're persistent, persistent and
stubborn,
right? You can't be that way with the creation, but you can be that way with the Creator. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to give us tawfiq to make dua to him with ad'iyah that are mustajaba, with du'as that are accepted by him, Jalla wa Ala, and that he allows us to purify ourselves through the tawheed of him and through supplicating to him, Jalla wa Ala. Hada amin wa amin, Allahumma amin. Hada wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina wa habibina sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama tasliman kathiran mazida. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.